Sono Manuel Di Geronimo, Spartan Racer, coach SGX, laureato in scienze motorie di osteopata. In questi video vi racconterò tutto sul mondo Spartan e OCR. Scoprirete insieme a me tutti i segreti dello sport più bello della Terra. Non esistono ostacoli troppo grandi, esistono solo motivazioni troppo piccole.
Okay.
Buongiorno a tutti ragazzi, oggi siamo qui con il grandissimo Robert Killian. Tutti lo conosciamo, uno dei più forti atleti del mondo, una persona speciale, un militare, e tutti siamo molto curiosi di conoscerlo meglio. Hi Robert, thank you for being here, and this video is for my YouTube channel, but I have many questions that people made me.
Okay.
But it's a big pleasure, and we are really thankful for your time. And the first question that I have to make to you is what everybody wants to know. Are you still working, or are you just an athlete?
Right now, I'm pretty much just an athlete. Right now I am just an athlete. I'm working part-time in the military, so I'm in the National Guard. So I have obligations 1 weekend a month, 2 weeks a year. But it's really as much as I want to. There's opportunities coming up in the beginning of the year that I may work January, February, March, and April. Maybe I'll come off of military work and then go into training for the season. But I'm also a coach, so I'm doing coaching.
For OCR tournament?
Yes, for obstacle course racing. I have 25 athletes. I unfortunately can't coach any more than that with my time. So that's part of my job, is making sure those athletes are prepared for their races to meet their goals. I think people underestimate just racing. There's a different side to it. I mean, your sponsors are really what supports you. So working with my sponsors to help promote, gear and products and to do photo shoots and interviews does take up quite a lot of time. So it's a job in itself, I would think.
Ok, la prima domanda che ho fatto a Robert è stata quello che penso molte persone vogliono sapere, se lavora ancora o fa solo l'atleta. Allora, cosa dire che Robert è tuttora un militare, però ha una sorta di permesso lavorativo. Lui vuole provare a lavorare tipo da gennaio a marzo e poi da aprile fino a settembre quello che fa è lavorare un weekend al mese. In più fa coaching a 25 persone e infine la cosa importantissima, cerca di lavorare con i propri sponsor per le immagini che sono quelli che realmente gli danno un supporto. So, with the sponsor, you can support the Spartan life? Like, you're able to travel, train, support the family with that?
Yeah, it's amazing. I think there are only maybe 3 athletes in the entire world that are relying solely on, racing, winning money, of course, for the competitions. But, having the assurance, as a family man, I mean, you have to have a minimum amount of money. I can't always rely on winning a race to support my family. So I have a certain amount that I need to meet, either that coming from the military or my sponsors, or I would not be able to do this professionally.
So, quello che ho chiesto, ho detto, quindi con gli sponsor riesci a vivere di questo, e lui è uno dei 3 atleti. Who are the other 2 athletes?
I would say John Albon. I think he's doing this full time, either in Europe, doing Sky Race or doing Toughest. Or,
and the third one, who is?
Ryan Atkins.
Okay. Yeah. Che con Albon e Ryan Atkins, quindi i 3 migliori atleti del mondo, sono le uniche persone che riescono a vivere di questo sport, grazie agli sponsor, al supporto militare, e non solo grazie alle vittorie di ogni competizione, ma bensì dagli sponsor. And tell me about your training. So, do you have a plan of your workout? A professional plan, a coach, or you just go to run?
Yeah, no, so I have 20 years experience of running and doing athletics, whether it be triathlon or military competitions. I do winter biathlon as well. So I was competing for that for the National Guard and doing North American Championships, doing some events in Spain, France. I've been to Kendushu to do international competitions with the military. And I think all those sports, combining those and a little bit of training that I learned from each one of those, I've developed a really good training plan specifically for obstacle course racing. And a lot of my training, I look at data. So I look at my heart rate variability, how recovered I am in the morning, or how much stress I've been putting on myself depending on the intensity of the workouts. and I base.
So you work with the heart rate.
Yes. So it's a percentage of balancing how many days you're working out at a very high intensity or a very low or threshold intensity. You really have to balance all those out. And I think that's what makes a successful training plan, is you don't have to go out there and train, you know, as hard as you can every single day. You really have to incorporate recovery, and you have to incorporate different intensities and also the amount of mileage that you need to do. I mean, we're out here running mountains at a long distance. It's an endurance race. It's not a sprint. There are sprint formats. So that's one of the things you got to look at: what distance you're doing, what type of environment you're in, and base all your training, because obstacle course racing isn't running on a track. It's not running, you know, on a road race where you know the conditions. You have to look at the specific venue that you're going to and what you're going to be facing at that venue, because everything is different.
So you are also going in many places to visit to just for training?
No, I just look at the similarities. Yeah, okay. Just looking, okay, this is going to be a mountain course, or this is going to be a flat course, or it's going to be on the West Coast, like we're at. It's very dry, it's not humid, versus, you know, maybe on the East Coast where there's rain, humidity, moisture,
so
bugs.
So you travel also for training?
Yes, not so much though.
Okay.
I'll travel for races, but I'll do those as training races. Okay. So I'll go to a race, not necessarily to win, maybe just to do some training, because there's no better training than to do an obstacle course race.
Okay.
Yeah. So I have different goals depending on which races I want to win, or some that maybe I just want to work on specific things, either obstacles or running, and maybe I'll do 2 laps, 3 laps, you know, just to get a good day.
Okay, I'm going to translate one.
Okay. Yeah.
Allora, la domanda che sono andata a chiedere a Robert è se ha un coach, se si allena in modo specifico o se si allena a caso. Quello che mi ha detto lui è chiaramente viene da 25 anni di esperienza come militare, triathlon, duathlon invernale, e lui chiaramente ha un programma combinato molto specifico per le Spartan. In più a questo, quello che ha, lavora tantissimo con la frequenza cardiaca, fa giorni ad alta intensità e giorni a bassa intensità, controlla sempre la frequenza cardiaca e fa una cosa nettamente professionale. Più quello che fa, va in vari posti per allenarsi, ad esempio in una condizione più asciutta come qua, in condizioni più umide, ha un programma di gare dove deve andare a vincere, il programma di gare che usa per allenamento, e magari fa 2 o 3 giri della stessa gara per prepararsi. È una cosa molto più spiccata. I'm asking this because we have great athletes in Europe,
yeah,
amazing, that you will see, but when they come here, they can't compare.
Yeah.
And what can I say to you? That all these athletes don't follow programs, they just
right.
go to run.
Right.
That's, I'm a coach, so they just don't check the heart rate, because probably they know. But this, I think, is the real point they're missing between you and them, that you do for professional in the professional way, probably yeah. also with the food, with everything.
Yes, everything.
Okay.
Recovery, balance. Yeah, it's all a balance. You have to have proper training with intensity and volume into consideration, working on improving your threshold, and then proper nutrition to fuel you, and then proper recovery in the form not only of sleep, but mobility as well.
Quello che gli ho detto, che io la cosa che percepisco, che in Europa abbiamo tantissimi atleti che arrivano qui e non riescono a competere, ma spesso gli atleti in Europa non hanno un programma di allenamento specifico, non lavorano magari con la frequenza cardiaca, è una cosa fatta più a sensazione. Una cosa che fa lui è comunque seguire un'alimentazione corretta, seguire un'intensità, un volume, una cosa molto più specifica. And how many times do you train the obstacles? For example, carry obstacles. How many times do you train? Because in the States are much, much heavier than Europe. So how many times you train? One example of your planning.
Yeah. So one of the things for me, specifically being in the military, we carry a lot of weight in our packs to do military training. So for me, I think having, you know, 10 years experience before coming into obstacle course racing, I'm just naturally built to carry weight sometimes.
Yeah.
So I don't maybe train as much as I should, but 2 days a week usually I'll do carrying. But that's the thing about obstacles is, you know, in a race you only have to do it once. So I'll see guys out there trying to do a 1 mile or 2 miles of carries. What I try to do after a run, I just spend 10 minutes and I have 5 minutes out, 5 minutes back. I'll just do a carry right as a cool down almost, right after a run, because you're already ready to go. You just have the sandbags there. It's a relatively lower heart rate. Sometimes I'll do a hill. Sometimes you know, I'll just do some flats, but yeah, 2 days a week.
And for specific training of obstacles, do you do or?
Yeah, so one of the things I incorporate, so, you know, when I won the World Championship in 2015, I was working full-time military. That was my job, you know, 6 a.m. to 5 p.m. I was working. And I write my programs specifically for my athletes to only train. You only need 2 hours a day, 2.5 hours yeah. max. And a lot of people think you need all this time, but as long as you can focus and dedicate 2 hours a day, it doesn't have to be to running. It can be to weight training, to circuit training, and that's what I do. So 2 days a week, I'm working on circuit training, working out in the gym, doing functional fitness that works all of the muscle groups that you're gonna be using in obstacle course racing. So I'm not out there doing bench press. I'm not out there doing heavy squats. I'm trying to work on the specific muscle groups that are going to make you a better obstacle course
racer. Like lunges, step ups.
Yeah, lunges, pull-ups, dead hangs. You have to work on grip strength, forearms. You have to be able to do pull-ups because they help you over walls. They help you when you're doing rigs. They help you on monkey bars. There's so many applicable things that just being able to do dead hangs, pull-ups, and you know, you do have to work the biceps because those help you in a situation that you may, you know, rope climb or you need to. A lot of people have different techniques, I would say, for obstacles. And depending on your strengths, I train people differently depending on if they have, you know, short arms or long arms. They might have a better reach and they might not have to be in a certain position. So I think when you get to that next level, it's a lot about learning the techniques on how to make you faster through obstacles and then also transitioning. So I try to implement what's called the 80-20 rule. So 80% of the workouts that you do are in a lower heart rate zone, and then 20% are at a high intensity. So the 20%, so let's say you have a 7 day week, 5 days you're doing, you know, a lot of endurance running, 2 days you're doing interval training, speed work, and that's gonna help you build a better threshold and make you faster when you're transitioning between obstacles and you have a higher heart rate.
Okay. Ho chiesto allora se lui allena specificatamente gli ostacoli, per esempio gli ostacoli da trasporto. Quello che mi ha detto è che viene da 10 anni di militare dove si deve sempre trasportare un sacco di cose, quindi non allena tantissimo questa cosa. Vede che tante persone tipo fanno un miglio con un sacco, ma nella Sparta non c'è. Quello che fa lui fa, per esempio, a fine allenamento 5 minuti all'andata, 5 minuti al ritorno a bassa frequenza cardiaca di allenamento degli ostacoli. Più lui lavora 5 giorni a settimana a bassa frequenza cardiaca e 2 giorni ad alta intensità. Si allena tutti i giorni. E una cosa che fa, lavora non con squat, bench press, però specificatamente con, ad esempio, dead hang, pull-ups, ostacoli, comunque esercizi di ostacoli. E, so, you run 5 times a week?
Yeah, about 5 days, and I also do cycling, so I'll, at most, my mileage is maybe 55 miles. I don't run a lot.
A week?
I mean, yeah, 55 miles a week, because the longest race, look, this is the World Championship, we're only running 13 miles. So I see a lot of athletes out there doing 70 or 100, and I'm like, why? Like, you're wearing your body down. You really only need a minimum of 35 miles, a maximum of maybe 50, 55 to train for the beast distance. If you're doing an ultra beast, that's different. Yes, then you need 70 miles if you want to perform well because you're doing a 30-mile race.
Yeah.
So you need to train at least 70 miles a week.
So after this, for the Iceland, you will train every day 50 miles?
20, yes.
Okay.
Because, you know, Joe did offer $1 million, so I...
And also Albon is here for the same reason.
I know, yes.
I want to tell you that.
But he... I don't know that I feel like this year there are a lot of athletes who worked very hard to earn a spot to the championship, and he had, this will be his first Spartan race the whole year.
Okay. Allora, quello che io ho chiesto se corre, quindi 5 volte a settimana, corre 5 volte a settimana, lavora tra 55 miglia a settimana. Lui consiglia di fare tra le 35 alle 50-55. Tenete presente, dice che una pista è massimo 13 miglia. Quindi non ha senso, secondo lui, allenare per grandi distanze. E poi chiaramente dopo proverà a allenarsi per Iceland, per vincere il milione di euro che si vince se vince 3 mondiali, oltre questo Iceland e Sparta, dove ci saranno anche grandi atleti che proveranno a vincerlo. Proverà ad allungare distanze anche a 20 miglia al giorno. però non consiglia di fare tante miglia, ed è quello che sconsiglia di fare a molti atleti. I have to say that it's different because in Europe it's more endurance than strength. So if you were running in Europe, you have to run more because who wins is who runs faster.
That's true.
The guy that will run tomorrow, we have promised for the Harry Upsal, but he's a great, amazing runner. And I, you didn't come in Austria, but he wanted to try to beat you there for see the difference of challenging.
Yes.
And for example, we have balanced obstacles that you don't have in States.
Yes, that's why I really love to compete in Europe. And I've been to Tyrol, to Austria the past 2 years. Unfortunately, I couldn't go this year because I had another race I was doing, Primal Quest, 5-day adventure race. And I think one of the things that I love about Europe is that, yeah, you guys do incorporate a little bit more of the balance obstacles, a lot of unknown stuff. You don't get a course map. There's a lot of very technical running too.
Yes, and it's much more technical.
The terrain and the actual course, I feel like you're saying, are harder than the obstacles. So whoever can run the best, yeah, is going to be the winner in a lot of the European races. But you still have different things in the States. The there's different grip holds on some of the rigs. They've done some monkey bars with a transition in the middle where you swing.
Yeah.
So they add some things that are very fun and a lot of carries. The chain carry isn't very heavy, or the tire carry. But the more you do that kind of stuff, it wears you out for other obstacles, where I feel like here in the States, you have a lot of carries and a lot of things that also wear you down. But I think that's what's exciting is you go to different places and it's a little bit different everywhere.
Is what we feel at the moment. Io ho detto che la differenza è che in Europa le gare sono molto più... le persone che corrono e vincono in Europa sono dei più grandi corridori che persone che allenano sugli ostacoli. E lui, come diceva, in Austria ha visto questa differenza perché i sentieri sono molto più tecnici, a differenza degli ostacoli, ed è una cosa che gli è piaciuta particolarmente tanto. Ed è per quello che gli piace correre in Europa. For this, actually, for us, we are here to say, why we're running on the street and we don't run for the sky place?
Yes.
And is what we feel, because if you were coming this year in Oberdorf, was much, much harder than that.
Yes, that's
was
what
one
I
1 mile and
I
a half of San Berkeri in the top of the mountain.
Yes.
In the middle was a twister, then a lot of river, and that's all. So it's different. Andorra, it's crazy race. Allier, where will be probably the European Championship next year, is a lot of mountain. You should see that for see the panorama and increase your balance.
Yes.
Stavo dicendo che quest'anno in Austria era differente la gara e che le gare sono molto più tecniche e per noi qui vediamo si corre nelle strade, non attraversiamo le piste da sci e ci sembrava molto strano. E you are also part of that father of two kids. For example, me have a baby, a really small baby, and this year is the toughest year for me because I'm not able to train, to sleep, to do all these things. How can you do that with two kids?
I don't know, because when I won in 2015, my daughter was only 3 weeks old. So we were not getting any sleep. I had, I think, maybe no pressure because I didn't think that I would do well. And then I ended up winning. And now looking back, I was like, how did I do that with two kids? Because even now, my son last night threw up, like 1 o'clock in the morning. I think he is having some altitude sickness, maybe because we're up at a higher elevation and the kids aren't so used to that. And it's difficult. Sometimes I travel without my family, but that doesn't make it any easier when I'm at home training and they're there. I try to balance it. I try to incorporate my kids into my training. So I have a backpack that I put my daughter in, or I'll have them, I have a stroller, Bob stroller, and I push them on a lot of my workouts, and it makes the workout harder. And they get more involved and have fun, and I get to spend some time with them. So I think that's a big balance. And a lot of times when I'm at home, I try to encourage all my athletes or anyone doing OCR to buy as much equipment as you can to have at home. I mean, you can do a lot with just a few sandbags, some kettlebells, a dumbbell, and a pull-up bar. You don't really need a whole lot of crazy stuff like in a gym. And you can do all your training at home while your kids are, playing around. And
so the kids is a part of your training workout.
Yeah, and I break it up. So I don't. So a lot of people go to the gym and they'll do 45 minutes nonstop. Maybe I only do 10 minutes and then I take a break, do another 10 minutes. But by the time the day is over, I spend almost 2 hours working on strength. I just break it up throughout the entire day.
We'll help you the strength. Yes. Quello che ho detto che Robert, a parte questo, è un padre, c'ha due figlie. Pensate che ha vinto il primo mondiale e la figlia aveva solo 3 settimane. Ho chiesto come fai a prepararti una cosa simile, come si fa? E lui mi ha detto che include i bambini nel suo allenamento, c'ha uno zaino dove porta la figlia, ha comunque un passeggino dove porta i bambini per correre, dice li utilizza anche nell'allenamento, perché lui si allena molto in casa con 2 kettlebell, un sandbag e comunque con una barra per i pull up, e quello che dice non è che ha bisogno estremamente di troppe cose per allenarsi, di palestra, però lui magari si allena 10 minuti, si ferma dietro i bambini e poi riparte. Ok, last question, thank you for your time. We'll say, give us one tip because you run that strong, or something that you do, some trick that you have, or something special that we want to hear by your side.
So I think one of the things people, kind of underestimate in obstacle course racing, like we've been talking about, is the terrain. And one of the things that I like to incorporate into my training is cycling. Like a lot of people are like, oh, well, you don't bike during an obstacle course race, you're running mountains, but cycling builds your quads. It makes you really strong, and the quad muscle is what you use for climbing mountains. So you can, and it's something you don't have to own a bike, you can have a stationary bike, you can go to a gym for spin class. And if you look at all the most successful athletes, Hunter McIntyre used to be a spin instructor. Ryan Atkins used to be a professional mountain biker. I have a triathlon background.
The strongest is a duathlon, the external champion of the world.
So I think
mountain bike.
Yeah, just get on a bike, maybe work on some power, some big gear training. You're gonna feel your quads, or even winter biathlon. Myself, Zuzana, we're really good at cross country skiing. I know that's big in Europe, skate skiing, classic skiing. So if you can't get on a bike, I would say do some cross training. You don't have to always work on running or always work on obstacles. You know, do something different, I think is my biggest tip.
Ok, ho chiesto un segreto, un consiglio che ci può dare Robert come ultima domanda. Quello che lui mi ha consigliato, consiglia tantissimo, sono sicuramente la bicicletta, perché la bici, dice lui, come tanti atleti, cioè Hopkins, come Soleil, sono tutte persone che incorporano nel loro programma allenamento la bicicletta, ed è una cosa che consiglia vivamente da utilizzare e di mettere nel programma. Thank you, Robert, for your time. You are amazing athlete and person. I wish you the best, and let's see how it's going tomorrow.
Yeah, take care, guys.
Ciao, ciao a tutti, al prossimo video.